Hello and welcome to this episode of sMater, a podcast by clinicians for clinicians, brought to you by Mater, an Australian leader in healthcare for more than a century. My name's Gillian Whiting and we're coming to you from Meanjin, the land on which this podcast is being recorded.
Hello, I'm Maggie Robin, community GP, rural GP obstetrician at Beaudesert Hospital and coordinator of Mater's GP Shared Care Education Program.
In this episode, we're talking about thyroid disease and pregnancy with Dr. Jo Laurie.
Jo is the Director of Obstetric Medicine at Mater Mothers Hospital and has practiced as an obstetric physician for the last 18 years.
Jo's also a researcher in the impact of maternal illness and pregnancy and the longer term.
She's joining us to talk about how thyroid disease is treated before, during and after pregnancy.
We are Mater.
We are Mater.
We are Mater.
This is sMater.
Jo, welcome to sMater.
Thank you for having me.
Okay, firstly, how common is thyroid disease in pregnancy?
So it's one of the more common medical conditions, but probably only about 1 to 2% of pregnant women will suffer from thyroid disease. So it's something that we're looking out for, but you won't see super commonly in general practice.
Can you explain the difference between hyper and hypo, just briefly?
Sure. So hyperthyroidism is when there's an excess of thyroid hormone produced by the thyroid gland. In pregnancy, that can be due to just the change in the hormones, the beta-HCG being elevated, and that's called gestational thyrotoxicosis or gestational hyperthyroidism, and that's a transient condition. And then the other sort of hyperthyroidism is generally Graves' disease, which is an autoimmune condition. Hypothyroidism is an underactive gland where there's not enough thyroid hormone produced. And the commonest cause of that is Hashimoto's thyroiditis is the name of the condition. And that is relatively common in women of childbearing age.
So, Jo, we know thyroid disease can cause problems for both mum and baby. If we focus first on hyperthyroidism, what is the cause? What are the indicators and what are the concerns for mum and for baby?
So if we're talking about Graves' disease or autoimmunity that pre-existed the pregnancy, it can impact the chances of the woman falling pregnant and then keeping that pregnancy in the first trimester. So it can increase the risk of miscarriage if it's poorly controlled. But like all conditions in pregnancy, if we can modify the underlying disease, treat it well with medications, the risks of adversity related to the condition is reduced and that women could have a very normal pregnancy. The signs and symptoms of hyperthyroidism are consistent with that in just the adult population. So women are usually hot, they might be losing weight, they might be quite sweaty, they might be tremulous with a tachycardia. And with Graves' disease specifically, they can have Graves' eye disease where they have a proptotic eye or a very bright, you can see white above the iris when you're looking at the patient. It's quite an obvious condition. Mm-hmm. So if it's pre-existing to pregnancy, you try to settle down for the pregnancy, and then in the early pregnancy, try to keep the thyroid hormone levels stable so that they can progress through a fairly normal pregnancy. It can have fetal impacts if even when the disease is well controlled due to the autoimmunity because that crosses the placenta to the baby. And so that's something that we tend to look after in hospital, be cognizant of and do some screening and surveillance of that baby.
How much can be treated by a GP and when do they need specialist care?
So hypothyroidism is actually very easily treated in general practice and we would prefer that be the case because you see them either pre-pregnancy or very early in the pregnancy. All that entails is that you know how much thyroxin they're on, you increase it automatically by 30%. Don't wait for the blood test, just pop the thyroxin dose up by 30% and then retest the TFTs in about 4 to 6 weeks after that to check for compliance and appropriate reduction in the TSH. If you're having difficulty with that, very happy to see the patient, but probably more easily we could just take a phone call and give some advice over the phone. There's a couple of traps for players in the replacement for thyroxin. The things that we tend to check with patients are that they're taking their medication, number one, that they're taking it first thing in the morning without any other vitamins, so making sure they're not taking it with iron or calcium, which can bind it and prevent its absorption, that they don't leave the tablets on the windowsill because if they get hot, particularly in Brisbane, they go off, and that their scripts are in date and, you know, the medication is actually good medication. So we go through that with them as well. And if it's still not able to get their numbers in the right profile, then we're very happy to see the patient to work with them on that.
Mm. And Jo, if you're asking someone to increase the dose by a third, how would you advise them to do that?
Yeah, so thyroxine is one of the really funny medications where you actually could take the whole week's worth just at once. Mm. But what we tend to do is we work out how many micrograms they have across the week and work out what a third of that is, and that's how you increase. So maybe you're on 75 micrograms every day, 7 days a week. The way you go up by 30% would be having two tablets on Saturday and Sunday. So 75 Monday to Friday, 150 Saturday and Sunday. And that's easier for the patient to take. We don't want them breaking tablets. Mm. And because the absorption is across the week, it doesn't actually matter tablet point of view.
Jo, can you explain for us what is gestational thyrotoxicosis and how do we work out if someone has gestational thyrotoxicosis or a different underlying thyroid problem?
Yeah, so that can be a bit challenging. So I guess the first thing that you look at is the TSH, and you'll note that the TSH is suppressed in women who have hyperactive thyroid. So then you go on to the next step of what is the free T4 and free T3. In gestational thyrotoxicosis, it's only usually marginally elevated. So you might have a T4 of around 25 and a T3 of around 5. Graves is usually a little bit more severe, so that could be 30 or 40 for T4. But the important thing is the antibody levels. So you want to test antibodies to check whether they have underlying Graves' disease, and that is a TSH receptor antibody or a TRAB. And if the TRAB is elevated, it's extremely likely they have Graves and they need referral urgently into the hospital for us to monitor their baby and work out what surveillance strategy we will use for that woman. Mm-hmm. With hypothyroidism, Hashimoto's, we are very interested in the anti-TPO antibodies specifically. So not the anti-TG, mm-hmm. but the anti-TPO. And if they're elevated, that's when you use your diagnostic pathway that's in the policy to note whether they need treatment to a TSH below 2.5 or whether they can have a treatment just to a TSH below 4.
Okay. Yeah. What's the difference between the thyroglobulin antibody and the TPO antibody?
So TPO is much more impressive for autoimmunity and has more impact on pregnancy outcome, whereas thyroglobulin just says that there's a little bit of inflammation in the thyroid gland and it's not useful at all mm-hmm. in helping us to determine what the risk is for that pregnancy.
Okay. Jo, what difference does it make if a woman with Graves' disease already has it under control when she falls pregnant, and how can you tell that it's not Graves when they've got a really low or undetectable TSH level?
So it's very hard with a person who's got known Graves to know whether their undetectable TSH level is important or not. And we tend to look at the free T4 and free T3 there to know what the hormone levels look like to determine whether they need treatment. Again, that's something that specialists do day to day, so very happy to see those patients in hospital. The tricky part with Graves is women who have had a definitive therapy, so they might have had their thyroid gland removed or they might have had radioactive iodine to treat their thyroid gland, so their thyroid function is actually normal, or they might even be on thyroxine. But their risk of neonatal Graves' disease, so the baby or the fetal Graves' disease, the baby getting issues with hyperactive thyroid still exists because the autoimmunity hasn't gone away. So we still check their TRABs, even though they might not have had their disease themselves for a long time. And if their TRABs are positive, we do have increased fetal surveillance and neonatal surveillance for that complication. Those antibodies are very good at crossing the placenta and they can live in the woman for 20 or 30 years after their incident Graves episode.
Women who have had a thyroidectomy and radioactive iodine treatment are recommended to wait 6 to 12 months before becoming pregnant to avoid side effects of radiation being transferred to the baby. Studies have shown that there is an increase in birth defects when pregnancy occurs within 6 months of treatment.
What does the fetal or neonatal surveillance look like?
Yeah, so we tend to look at their heart rate to make sure that the baby's not tachycardic. We do additional ultrasound scanning to look for a goiter in the baby and to look for evidence, again, of tachycardia or even heart failure in the baby throughout the pregnancy. Those babies have a cord blood to look for their thyroid function at birth and also another thyroid function test at about day 5, and we'll check their antibodies as well. It's a transient condition in the baby, but we obviously don't want them to become unwell with hyperthyroidism in those very early days.
Jo, during pregnancy, how safe is medication and should they stop as soon as they know they're pregnant?
So thyroxine is extremely safe, so there's no reason to stop that. And we talked about the 30% increment. With regards to antithyroidal treatment, they definitely shouldn't stop their medication, but their medication does need to be reviewed. And we would help do that either by phone call if we can't get them in urgently, or you know, we can usually see them within a week or two. Our preferred antithyroid medication in the first trimester is PTU, because we know that it definitely doesn't have any association with embryogenesis issues. There's very weak evidence that carbimazole might cause some issues with baby's development. However, in the second trimester and the third trimester, there's an increased risk of liver failure with PTU, so we swap them back. So they might have been on carbimazole before the pregnancy. We put them on PTU in first trimester and swap them back to carbimazole in second and third. Or maybe they're on PTU before, continue that through the first trimester, swap them to carbimazole in the second and third. Because pregnancy improves your autoimmunity, so if you've got autoimmune disease, it usually gets better in the pregnancy. Often these women can come off treatment in the second and third trimester anyway, and we are very happy to manage that.
What about postpartum? The mum's thyroid function is likely to rebound and become hyperthyroid. What is the danger period and what should GPs be looking for?
So we hopefully have identified them as being at risk of that and organised for them to have an appointment with their endocrinologist or endocrine service at about the 6 to 8 week mark, because that's when it happens. So they're usually fine for the first 6 weeks postpartum. And then if they're going to have a flare of disease, and this is any autoimmune disease, it'll occur between 6 and 8 weeks. Mm. If for some reason they have been missed for their follow-up, that is the time to do a thyroid function test and refer them urgently if it's abnormal, because they're probably not on medication by that stage. Mm. So they might need to be remedicated to bring that under control. Thyroxine, we talked about increasing it by 30% in the pregnancy. You need to reduce to pre-pregnancy doses at the end of the pregnancy and check their thyroid function for stability again 4 to 6 weeks afterwards.
Jo, in the past there's been a debate about subclinical hypothyroidism. What can you tell us? What is the latest research on that?
Yeah, so people get very concerned that their baby's IQ might be less if their thyroid is not perfect during the first trimester. And I think this is, there was a very large Scandinavian study which showed that if you are significantly abnormal in your thyroid function, that maybe those babies had a slight reduction of 1 to 2 IQ points. However, we're not talking about this very mild degree of subclinical hypothyroidism. So we need to reassure women that their babies will be fine, that we will treat to the parameters that are in that pathway. So if their TSH is 4 or below and they're antibody negative, that's normal. If they're antibody positive, that's antibody TPO, then it's down to 2.5 as the treatment target for TSH. We use that as the parameters to treat them. If they're 2.6 or 2.7, it's not going to make a massive difference to that baby at all. And we need to reassure women that they're doing very well and that we're, you know, we're working with them to make sure that we're optimising their pregnancy.
Is there a clear way to communicate that with women?
I think just to reassure them that this is a very minor, very, very slight blood test abnormality and it doesn't have massive clinical consequences is important to get that message across.
Research shows that the consequences of maternal hypothyroidism on babies are the result of various factors acting in combination. While women shouldn't be concerned about neuropsychological effects, it's also important that for their general health and the health of their baby during pregnancy, they ensure their thyroid function is within safe parameters.
Jo, do all women need thyroid function testing as part of their routine antenatal blood tests?
The short answer is no, and that's not what the, you know, College of ONG suggest. It's not what the Australian Endocrine Association suggest. However, if you're concerned about a woman, if she has risk factors, any family history of thyroid disease, you know, it is worth checking and it might reassure you both that that's not part of the concern for that woman. Fatigue as a feature of hypothyroidism is really tricky because nearly everybody's tired, so that wouldn't be an indicator. I don't think there's any harm in testing, but we don't need to get everybody to do it.
How much support is there for GPs who need to know the pathway for thyroid disease and pregnancy?
Yeah, so I would call their attention to the pathway that's in our policy, which gives you a decision tree to follow. depending on what the blood tests look like and what the woman's risk factors otherwise are. And I think if you can go there first and work out where she might sit in that pathway, that's a really good first step. However, the obstetric medicine service at Mater Mothers is available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And we're always happy to take phone calls with questions from GPs about anything, including thyroid disease. So if you feel that you aren't certain of what the woman needs based on the pathway, or she has a slightly more complex history, perhaps she's had thyroid cancer in the past, please just give us a ring and let us know, and we should be able to answer most questions over the phone, or at least arrange an urgent follow-up for that woman.
A detailed guideline on thyroid management in pregnancy with referral pathways can be found on Marta's website. A link to this guide can be found in the show notes.
Thanks so much, Jo. But before we let you go, we want to introduce you to our little segment called The Checkup. So we want to know more about Jo, the person, the medical professional. So we're going to ask you five quick questions. Well, sure. Maggie's going to ask you five quick questions.
Thank you.
You ready?
Yes, terrified. Interested.
Jo, what was your first concert?
Probably The Cause.
Who is the most underrated member of the hospital team?
We have high-risk midwives that look after our patients. They're called the OMGP, the Obstetric Midwifery Group Practice, and they are amazing, and I don't think they receive the amazing accolades that they should.
Yes, I've worked with them as well, and they work very hard.
Yes.
If a genie could grant you one wish, what would it be?
More time in the day.
That'd be nice.
Yes, I think that would be it.
And along those lines, if you had a day off today, what would you do?
I would take my dogs for a walk, because that's one of my favourite things to do, and then sit in the sun.
If you weren't doing this job, what would you be doing?
I would be a florist. No, I've actually always wanted to be a doctor, and I'm very pleased that I chose that pathway, and I still love what I do every day.
Flowers could be a hobby, Jo.
Yeah, I mean, I grow them successfully sometimes and not others, but I just think flowers are beautiful. I think nature is beautiful.
Well, we're glad you're doing what you're doing. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
For our listeners at home or in the car or having a well-deserved break between patients, thank you for tuning in.
See you next time on Smarter.